PCIe, aka Peripheral Component Interconnect Express. It replaced PCI and replaced it in two major ways. Firstly, it was a serial computer expansion bus standard, whereas the original PCI worked in parallel with a total fixed bandwidth amount. That is, the more components that utilize that bandwidth, the slower its access became for each component per se in the system, as opposed to PCIe, which if you added in more components, then sure, the maximum bandwidth is still there. However, the maximum bandwidth would ultimately be shared across all devices. PCIe also carried with it a new slot configuration, which comes in sizes of X1, X2, X4, X8, and X16. Most games will use the X16 slot available on their motherboard to power their graphics card. However, the PCIe interface can also power hard drives, SSDs, Wi-Fi, and Ethernet connections. Though here is where the fun starts, right after this sponsor spot. This video is sponsored by Dashlane. If you are sick and tired of missing out on pre-orders for PS5s, Xbox Series X's, and RTX 3080s, then Dashlane is the solution for you. Need to quickly log into that account, auto-fill those shipping details, credit card details, and then click purchase? Then Dashlane has got you. It's also cross-platform and has a built-in private VPN. Now, if you use the link dashlane.com/techyescity, then you can get Dashlane completely free on your first device. And if you decide you want to upgrade to a more premium option, then you can get 50% off using the link and the coupon code in the description below. Easy, let's get back to the video. PCIe, which was introduced 17 years ago in 2003, has gone through generations of improvements, starting with, of course, Gen 1, with an X16 slot or 16 lane configuration supporting speeds of 4 GB per second both ways. In other words, 8 GB in total read and write. And this was polled at 2.5 GHz. Now, this polling is very important. This is what we're going to talk about later with the RTX 3090 and the results. Next in the improvement tier was PCIe Gen 2, supporting double the polling rates at 5 GHz and double the transfers at 8 GB per second each way for 16 GB in total. PCIe Gen 3 essentially doubled the transfers yet again for 32 GB in total, and the polling rates were at 8 GHz. Now, PCIe Gen 4, which was introduced to the mainstream gamer by AMD with their X570 motherboard launch, supports 64 GB per second and a polling rate of 16 GHz. PCIe Gen 5, which will be later released in the future, will then double the speeds of PCIe Gen 4. Though how much bandwidth does your graphics card exactly need? And say for instance you're a 4K gamer, will something like PCIe Gen 3 suffice? Well, graphics cards, or as I like to call them, graphics cards, work with 32-bit color. This 32-bit color mode at 4K 30fps, for example, requires approximately 1 GB per second transfers. Double that to 60fps, 2 GB per second. 120fps 4K gaming, that will need 4 GB per second transfers. However, these are only approximations to understand how much bandwidth a gamer actually needs. So in theory, even a PCIe Gen 2 X16 slot is more than enough for an RTX 3090 overclocked, right? Well, actually, yes. Starting off with the games, the numbers, and the benchmarks, our test system consists of an i9-10900K for PCIe Gen 2 and Gen 3 tests. And then on the AMD side, we are using a 3950X for PCIe Gen 4 tests, since the Intel side doesn't have Gen 4 support from the CPU just yet. But both these CPUs were used with 3600 MHz CL16 memory to ensure that the RTX 3090 would be pegged near 100% GPU utilization as much as possible. Though onto the numbers. Here we can see that Shadow of the Tomb Raider, PCIe Gen 2 X16 was coming awfully close to the successors Gen 3 and 4 at X16 speeds. Though limiting the Gen 3 bandwidth to X4 showed that this RTX 3090 that was overclocked was starting to power through these limits. Though not by a whole lot. Horizon Zero Dawn showed a pretty similar trend, though it was slightly more in favor of having more bandwidth available. Doom Eternal, very similar, showing the PCIe Gen 3 X4, similar to Gen 2 X8, and of course, the OG Gen 1 X16 was reaching its limits here. The Division 2, yep, nothing to see here, folks. And then lastly, Modern Warfare, same scenario as before. However, testing 1080p on the flip side showed an identical trend to the other games at 4K. So basically, summing it up, Gen 2 X16 is more than enough for even an RTX 3090 overclocked in 2020. Though you may have noticed that Gen 3 X16 on the Intel side of things was beating Gen 2 X16 by slightly better margins in all titles. And you may be wondering, why is this? Well, this has to do with what I believe is the polling rates. And we hinted at this earlier, but basically the difference between 5 GHz and 8 GHz is a 60% increase in the polling rates. So the CPU polls the GPU shader essentially faster, giving that slight increase that you see in the FPS numbers. Gen 4, if we were to theoretically put this on the Intel side of things, this would in turn give us slightly more FPS as well, but it would start suffering significantly from diminishing returns. An easy way to help conceptualize this is to just look at polling rates on mice, where Razer, for example, wants to go from 1000 Hz with an average of 0.5 milliseconds delay, polling all the way up to 8000 Hz. An 8-fold increase in polling rates, but only an absolute drop in 0.4375 milliseconds average. As opposed to say 1000 Hz versus 125 Hz, we have a much larger drop in absolute average delay of roughly 3.5 milliseconds average. If you're trying to figure out the math, just think that some polls will hit at the start of the wave and some will hit at the very end, hence why it averages out. And so there it is with RTX 3090s. If you want to put these in SLI, overclock them on Gen 3 X8 slots, it's going to be absolutely fine, though I really don't think your wallet would be. However, these results were ultimately a big surprise for me personally. I thought the RTX 3090 would require a bit more bandwidth, but the numbers and testing always paints the biggest picture. Though keep in mind, although you won't need to seriously worry about PCIe bandwidth for gaming for some years to come, even on a Gen 3 X16 motherboard, what if there was a revolutionary breakthrough in the way that your motherboard and computer graphics were processed? Well, you'd probably just go out and buy a new motherboard with the latest and greatest PCIe Gen 6.9. So there it is with PCIe Gen 3 versus Gen 4. It's nothing to worry about on any modern day graphics card through an X16 slot. And in fact, Gen 2 X16 is still okay. Say what? Though currently the biggest difference between PCIe Gen 3 and Gen 4 is actually, I believe, on the NVMe side of things, where the X4 slots do gain a lot more speeds on PCIe Gen 4 motherboards, where you've got those higher speed SSDs running at higher speeds, because the throughput is ultimately doubled going from Gen 3 X4 to Gen 4 X4. And with all that aside, if you guys enjoyed today's video, then be sure to hit that like button for us. Also, if you're enjoying the content around tech, yes, city, then be sure to hit that sub button, ring that bell, and you'll get the content as soon as it drops. I'll catch you in the next tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.